particular way of calling, a particular way of answering. But in whichever way, what we encourage is that if you feel pressed, feel moved, if you feel motivated or gingered up in your spirit to render service for God or for mankind, simply obey.
Okay, sir. Thank you so much. Now, you have raised some important point or salient point that there is need for you to distinguish that
who is calling you.
Yeah, and what he is calling you for. Now, let me come to a brother who is a politician and a child of God. How comes that a lot of the politicians we have will say, my people want me to serve them, or God is calling me to serve them? But the moment they are sworn into office, what we see is rather different from the earlier statement, say, I want to serve my people. What's the reason behind this?
You know, most times when people get into offices or to a very high position, they forget where they are coming from. They forget the purpose why they are there. You know, we are ambassadors of Christ. And as an ambassador to a country, you are like the president representative in that country.
That's right.
You do not produce orders. Orders comes from the president. Your own is to implement. So we have our orders written as Christians in the Bible. But when people get into office, they forget that they are answerable to God first.
That's
before
right.
They think about any other man. You know, if you look at the life of Moses, there are always two parts to it. The people will murmur. They will look at what they have said and will still go back to God.
This is
what you have called me for. What do I do? But now when Aaron was also faced like that, he succumbed to like what we are saying, to the people's. So politicians, when they get into office, forget that primarily they represent God. They are symbol of authority representing God. And because they don't know why they are called, they always forget that I am here to serve God, that I am accountable to God. One of the things that made me not to talk bad about any other politician while we were contesting. I always remember, when I want to talk, I always remember Matthew chapter 12, verse 36, where the Bible says that every idle word will be brought before judgment seat.
That's right.
So when I remember that, in the election, there was no name that was not, they were calling me our tomatoes, they were saying this. The governor himself was abusing me. But I would turn around to say, should I be like them? No, I should be a politician with a different, because I'm coming from a different society. And anytime I remember that, in Proverbs chapter 20, verse 27, the Bible says that the spirit of man is the candlestick of the Lord, searching the inward parts. So I'm always careful that my spirit does not contradict what I want to say.
Yeah.
Not that I say something and what I'm doing is different. So politicians will say a thing. They are deceiving. Their own is just to get what they want.
A lot of,
but in their heart is deceit, forgetting that God is making a record. The candlestick of your spirit. No, God knows that this is what you said. And once you do not do it, you will now be faced with the reality of Saul. Saul, before he got into office, he was endowed with the spirit of God.
Yeah.
But when he turned around, another spirit followed him. So you might be in the office. Once they leave, Christians, when they get into office and leave God, they move the spirit of the devil. And that controls them. And you know, they cannot produce fruitful results except the church pray for them.
Once the Holy Spirit is not in you,
you are gone.
The fruit of the Spirit will not be seen. The Bible says the fruit of the Spirit is love.
Yes.
So the aspect of love for God people will be missing.
Yes.
And as a result, service, it will no longer be service, it will be disservice to the people. Now, Venerable Sir, you will help us here. Which service comes first, God or humanity? And what Bible reference do you think can come to fore?
Let me give you two Bible verses that looks antithetical.
Okay.
Yes. It is now. It now depends on the individuals.
Okay.
To decide. The first reference is 2 Corinthians chapter 8, verse 5, which says, "And this they did." 2 Corinthians chapter 8, verse 5. "And this they did, not as we hoped, but first gave their own selves to the Lord and unto us by the will of God."
If you look at that very scripture, you are supposed to give yourself to the Lord first before you can please the people.
That's right.
That is why we tell people, if we bring it to our contest, like our brother was saying, if you really want to go to into the corridor of powers and you expect to make a change, first of all, you know, be sure that you are a believer. Because the pressure there can turn you against the people entirely. People begin to say, like what you asked just now, what has happened to this man? I thought he said he was going there to represent. So, I thought he goes to church. I mean, things like that. So this one is saying, the people, before they start giving to us, they first of all gave themselves
to the Lord.
To the Lord. Now, when you go to Matthew chapter 5, verse 16, Matthew 5:16 says, "Let your light so shine before men, that they may see your good works and glorify your Father which is in heaven." This was Jesus Christ speaking. The other passage was Paul, the apostle, speaking. Jesus Christ was God. And if you understand this very scripture, he said, "Let your light, first of all, so shine before men, that they may see your good works and turn around to glorify your Father who is in heaven." That was God speaking. In other words, what God expects here is that as his own children, if we are truly his own children, we should serve the people, do what is needful, make sacrifice. And when we have done this, let the people be the one to turn around to say, "Kai, this man is different. He must be a child of God. Oh, glory be to God who brought this man to us as a governor or as a senator or as a local government chairman." So this is talking about, God here is talking about service to the people first. Service to the people first. You remember one centurion whose daughter was sick? Servant was seriously sick. They came to Jesus and said, "Please come and attend to him, because this man deserves your attention because he has been very good to the people, even built synagogue for his people." So that is service to people, not using God to cover people's eyes. That is what happens during campaign. You see politicians jumping from one church to the other, some jumping from the Muslims, one jumping from one mosque to the other. They want to show they will attend all services.
Exactly.
Yes, whether invited or uninvited, so that you will know that they are children of God, that they are born again. But when they are voted and you look at, oh, they are children of God, let's give them a chance. As soon as they win, that is the end. They barricade and know themselves from against the people. You can't assess them, even like what we experience in the National Assembly. I was telling somebody of recent. I know of a member, current member of House of Rep. He was there in the last, in the 8th Assembly. He's there again now. But when he collected the form, Express of Interest form, he came to me, brought the form, almost named a venerable. I've just coming from my party secretariat. I've collected, you know, the extension everywhere. They don't want me to go, but that's why I said before I start campaigning. I want to bring it to you for you to bless it for me. Inside me, first of all, I say, for 4 years you are there. I have visited your office, invited you to fellowship, to pray weekly. For 4 years you have not attended one day. Now you have just collected form. You ran to me. You remember there is a chaplain.
Exactly.
Now, do you know, since one till today, yeah, is in the night assembly. I have gone to his office more than 5 times again. Now he has not come to the fellowship to worship with us. But during election, he was able to run to me. Remember, there is a chaplain. Now, if I talk to him, we say I'm very busy. He gives all sorts of excuses. So it depends on individuals. For somebody who is already a child of God, you are sure you have already given your life to my brother who says he's already a child of God, he's already even offering service in the church as a lay reader. Now he has seen the need, he has seen a call to go and serve the people on a wider terrain. Fine, he's already serving God. He wants to now go to a terrain where he can serve the people more. No problem. But for those who are already there, and maybe he has already made it in life there, out there, is not yet a good believer, he may decide to contest. If he wins, he should see office as something that comes from God and also come and honor God. So whichever angle you are coming from, it's really, it's immaterial to me. But what is paramount is that every man or woman should know that the purpose of being here is to serve God and to serve man. If you look at our old catechism, it is conveniently divided into two parts. Our duty towards God and our duty towards man. Mm. We should not be found wanting on both.
Mm. Wow. So, from every indication, you must have the vertical and the horizontal relationship.
Yes.
When the vertical relationship is there and the horizontal relationship is
balanced.
There, is balanced. Mm. It means that you first of all serve God, and that will give you the ability to be able to serve
the people.
So if there is no God in you, there is no way you are going to render any meaningful service to the people.
Yeah.
So I want to believe that part of the problems we have today, a lot of people who say are Christians and are going in to serve the people have not actually served God. And the moment they get there, they will get swallowed up by the terrain in politics. Now, sir, let me come to you. Mr. Biopo, must you be a partisan politician in politics? And is being a party card carrying member a sin?
There are two aspects to it.
Exactly.
If you actually want to have desire to contest in Nigerian society, to contest and serve the people and God, you must be a card carrying member of a political party. The Electoral Act did not give that leverage of independence where you can come as an independent
candidate.
Yeah.
You must be card carrying member of a political party. The form CF001 that they will give you for you to fill your particulars. In the second, the number two section of it, they'll ask for the political party you are contesting.
Yeah.
So you need to be a card-carrying member. Now, not just card-carrying member, you must be an active member to show to the people that right at the party level I can lead you, then I can also lead you in the outer society.
Mm-hmm.
So you must, if that is when you have the you are convinced within you that you have a call to serve the people. It's not that people, it's not that my people are calling you. My people, if let's say 500,000 persons are in a particular constituency and 7 persons are coming to tell you to come and contest, you say my people are calling you. No. That is not, in statistics, that is not what to be compared with. So if you are convinced that you can offer your services, you must be in political party. And you must be active. You cannot be in political party and be a passive member. And you think the people will trust you with power.
Mm-hmm.
No, they will not. So, as Christians, we need to move out of that. I cannot be in politics because of one thing or the other. And move to active politics. Because if we don't, there is no vacuum in political terrain. It's always filled. That's why if somebody, if the president dies today, they'll conduct a by-election to fill that position. So if we as Christians to say we will not be in active politics, the unbelievers will be there.
Yes.
The politics, you know, can the position will be filled amongst Nigerians, not people from Cameroon, amongst Nigerians. So we as Christians need to step forward. Yes, we know that as clergymen, you will not be to contest. It's either you resign from your position as a priest and come to the political terrain to contest. After all, Reverend Father in the Third Republic in Benue State was a governor, Reverend Father Moses.
You don't even need to go far. In 1999 to 2007, in Taraba State.
In Taraba State, Jolly Yami.
Reverend Jolly Yami.
Uh-huh. So as people of the higher calling, you have another call to represent God and to show us the ways of God.
Mm-hmm.
It will not be advised as a person. I will not advise that they be in active politics. But they can be passive. How they can educate their members what politics is all about. That if you don't vote, if you don't go out to vote, a wrong person will be voted into. And you are bound by the Bible. In Romans chapter 13, verse 1 to 7, where the Bible says that obey all authorities.
Mm-hmm.
So if you decide to say that Christians should not worship on Sunday, you allowed it because you said Christians and politics cannot work together. So we just have, as Christians, come out, be active in politics. We can't carry members if you are not a priest.
Mm-hmm.
And if you are not this person that is afraid to go out, or if you have the time to go around for politicking, please be active. Don't just stay in your house and be analyzing. Come and show to the people that you can analyze political terrain.
Mm-hmm.
And once you do that and they see what you have in you, perhaps you are not seeking for elected position. When they get into office, they will remember you as a strategic person. And they will place you at strategic position where you will make policies. And it is we Christians that ordinarily supposed to make policies for the unbelievers. Not the other way around. But if you allow it, they will make the policies and we are bound by the Bible to obey.
Okay, so if you are fully convinced that you are called into politics, be partisan. Go into it. And there is need for you to be a card-carrying member of a political party of your choice. Because without being a card-carrying member, you cannot contest elected position. Anything to chip in as we go on break.
Yes, you know, you ask the question whether carrying a card of a political party is a sin.
Mm-hmm.
I want to say no. Being registered, duly registered,
that's right.
The card attests to your registration as a full member of that very party.
Mm.
So being registered in organizations that we sit down around the table to determine how the commonwealth of the nation which you belong to will be shared is not a sin. It's like saying they want to share land in your family land, and they ask every member of the family to gather on the round table discuss how it will be partition and all that, and you go to such a meeting, that cannot be a sin at all. So one of the cardinal objectives of our department is to sensitize Christians to participate actively in politics. I like the word used. Don't just sit down and become a political analyst in your family with your wife and children. You are sitting before the television analyzing who will win next, who will not win, who is doing well and who is not doing well. But on election day, you also sit down in your house analyzing whether the queues are long or short, whether people are snatching by law, but you are not participating. By so doing, you cannot change anything. In Nigeria's system, constitutionally, if you do not belong to a political party, you cannot participate.
Mm.
You can only just be a spectator, and we should not, put ourselves in that kind of a corner.
All right. Thank you so much. So, what we are saying in essence is that 2023 is coming. Start now.
Yes.
Strategizing. Being
a member of a political party.
Attend their meetings.
Attend their meetings. If you are fully convinced that God is calling you, go into it.
Yeah. Present
the
yourself.
Time to say politics is a dirty game is archaic, is over. Politics is no longer a dirty game. It's what every Christian must involve in. Because if you don't involve in it, some other people who don't have the capacity to serve will get there and serve themselves and bring in policies that is very, very bad, and you will be in for it. So we want to go on a short break, and when we come back, we will continue our discussion.
course, we are glad to know that you are still there, and we want to continue our discussion. We still have in the studio the Venerable Joseph Unwaya and Engineer Biopo, who is a politician and a child of God par excellence. And we still want to continue with our discussions. We encourage the viewers to please call in for comments and contributions. You can reach us through our Facebook page, Twitter handle, YouTube. All of those are various channels to reach us. And if there are any messages you want to send in, please send it in and we will read it to the general audience. Now, let me come to you, Engineer Biopoma. Do Christianity and politics mix? And if they mix, what do you think is the reason?
Christianity is the way of Christ, and politics is like a service to mankind. So if you bring the two together, you know that politics, when well defined, and Christianity, they are the same. Because now, if somebody comes to preach to me, or if I go to preach to somebody, that is Christian way of compacting somebody, I must be political enough to discern, like our father said, what the situation of this person is. You know, you preach not just to preach, but you preach to convict and convert the next person. And politics, if you look at campaigning, is our way of preaching. You preach to the people.
Converse for votes.
You converse for votes. And it can only work when you are doing the right way. And as a Christian, when your steps are ordered, you bring politics and Christianity together. That when you talk, like as I quoted earlier in Proverbs chapter 20, verse 27, your heart is saying the same thing with your mouth. Once it comes to that stage, politics and Christianity works together. But if what you say is different from what you are thinking about, then at that point, politics and Christianity doesn't mix. Because as soul, body, and spirit, they all work together. And as a Christian that has the Spirit of God in me, I must walk as a Christian, I must serve as a Christian, and I must play politics as a Christian. And if I must play politics as a Christian, then Christianity and politics works together. And now, the Bible will look at it as the policy of our life.
Mm-hmm.
And now, it is from the Bible, if you look at all constitutions, that the like American Constitution, first came out from the Bible. If it is drawn from the Bible, it means that Christianity and politics is the same. If you look at the national anthem, after the second chapter, if you look at it, it's a prayer.
A God of creation.
On its own, it's a prayer. And it can take only a Christian to bring such prayer into being. When they were writing, they did not just sit down to write. And at the end, they said, God, so help me God at the pledge. So help me God. And once you bring godliness into what you are doing, you bring the two, humanity and divinity, together. And so Christianity, as a man, last Sunday we were discussing, last two Sundays we were talking about the Christ being man and being divine in our Sunday school.
Yes.
Now, the Bible says, I have the mind of Christ in me. So, and as a Christian and as a politician, then I have the mind of Christ in me, leading me into politics. And so Christianity and politics work together if you will obey what the Lord says.
Okay, thank you so much. Venerable, do you still have something on this same question? Do politics and Christianity mix? And what are some of the reasons?
If you say whether they are the same, I can say they are not the same. But I will conveniently say Christianity and democracy. Democracy is a type of political way of governance. It's a branch of politics that if you adopt it, you almost find what the principles akin to that of the principles of Christianity. Because you can also come across political ideologies that are very, very antithetical to the policies that we find in the church, in the Bible, or Christian policies. That is why I say whether they are the same.
Okay, so that is a thin line.
You cannot just say they are the same wholesale. Mm-hmm. But if you adopt democracy and democracy is practiced as it's supposed to be, democracy is talking about equality, about fairness, about giving everyone fair hearing, fair due, and all that, majority having the day, minority should not,
majority decide.
Majority decide, no one should be marginalized, there should be fairness in everything.
Mm.
All these principles are akin to what we preach as Christians. If you read the Sermon on the Mount, Matthew chapter 5, 6, 7, you will discover that most of the principles you will see there are just the democratic principles that will make society a fair place to be. So to that extent, I would say they miss. A Christian can participate in politics. But when you just say, there are some types of government that are so autocratic, dictatorial. There are some people who apply Machiavellian principles, and it can be very draconian in nature, and they will not be compatible with the principles of Christianity.
Yes.
But if democracy, we know, is the most popular type of government in the world.
Yeah.
So if you go by democratic principles, you see that they can miss.
All
and
right.
The Christian can participate actively.
Right. Thank you so much, sir.
Yes.
Let me come to you. Where did the church get it wrong in involving in politics?
If we look at where the church gets it wrong, is when we assume that politics is not for Christians. That is where we get it wrong. You know, sorry to mention it, like Jehovah's Witness, they believe that you don't need to vote and be voted for, that their kingdom is heaven. We are citizens of heaven. But it's also true that we are citizens of Nigeria.
Yeah.
It's also true that I am from Kola, by a village in Akuto Logun of River State. It's true about me. So if I say I am a citizen of Kola, I'm a citizen of from River State and Nigeria, I'm not also lying. So if you look at it, the church has seen Christianity to say this is for unbelievers. It is not true. It is never true.
No, I don't know if I can come in there.
Mm.
I think it's a great fallacy. It's an error.
Okay.
For believers to think that we are not supposed to participate in politics and all that. What you say by that is you want to lead the affairs of your life here on earth
in the hands of
an unbeliever.
Mm.
I mean, do you know, it's very costly. The price you pay for such is that people whom you are better than will rule you and lord it over you, and take decisions which you must obey.
Mm.
And at the end of the day, are you going to do away with the Christian principle that say you must obey those in authority? If you surrender the authority of this nation to unbelievers and they are governing you, whatever law they come up with, you must be ready to abide with it. So to me, it's not right for you to say Christians should not participate in politics. What is politics? It's about the politics, the discussion, the science and art of governance. And in fact, let's take it away from, if you use the art of governance, people may not understand. It's about power sharing. It's about sharing the national cake. It's about know how the cake will come. who will share it, who will take a lion's share, who will take the little part of the cake. That is all what politics is all about. So leaving it in the hand of unbelievers to say, I don't care, it's not I'm not concerned about it, is a very, very terrible mistake. And again, Archbishop, you know, this sense, there is this deep sense of parousia, the second coming of our Lord Jesus Christ, which we quite encourage you to control the lifestyle of every believer, the consciousness that we are not going to be here forever. But late Archbishop Bensi Idahosa, whom that many people refer to as the father of Pentecostalism in Nigeria, said it boldly before he died. You don't destroy the present world because you are hoping to go to another you have not yet entered. Don't destroy the present world. The Bible says they that left their father and their mother and their houses and their property to follow me, they will be blessed here, and in the life to come they will be given eternal life. In other words, a reward is of twofold. God will bless us here, and when we die, he will give us eternal life. So you don't say, I'm not concerned about what is happening here. That is why when I see a Christian dressed shabbily, I see a Christian is not ready to live well, he is unkept, and you, dirtiness will not take you to heaven. Poverty will not take you to heaven.
Yes, sir.
Pray that God bless you here, and participate in what is going on here, then make sure you do the right thing that will prepare you for the world to come.
Yes, sir. Thank you so much. So don't be too earthly conscious that you become heavily in heavily conscious and earthly useless.
Useless. That is the language.
Yes. Engineer, quickly, should a church form political party? What do you think?
No, they should not. The church should not form political party. It's because, you know, the church, suppose, if you form political party, and your member decides to join another political party, you have asked him to leave the church. You've already indirectly asked him to leave the church. And the church should not actually to be even to have
partisan
to say we are for this political party. No. Because in the same church, you have members of APC, you have members of PDP, you have members of AAC. So, and they all come to service. They all pray the same time. As a priest, when you offer communion, you don't give to one political party, you give to all. So the church does not need to come into forming political party. But you can build your members with ideology. You can indirectly even get a political party. If the church have an ideology and the people are keyed to it, you see one particular people of the same church going towards one political party because they have the same mindset. But it must be a preparation ground. You must prepare them ahead of the time, not when, like 2023, by 2022 December, they are saying that, everybody, every Anglican should go to this place, or all Catholics should go. No, no, no. By 2020, this year, you must do sensitization to make the people know that they need to be interested in politics and to put away the word to say politics is dirty. It is not dirty. It is not dirty. This shall orientate the values of the people. I did a course in Harvard Kennedy School where they talk about negotiating community values. I think the Anglican Church, Malosa, needs to revalue our people to say, do they believe that politics is dirty? Even if it is dirty, it is us as Christians need to go and wash it to be better. We need to make it use our Christian values to wash it so that we can get a political ideology, and the people in our church will follow that ideology. And what are those ideologies? In Galatians chapter 5, verse 22, the ideology has stated the fruit of the spirit. Teach the people the fruit of the spirit. So when they go into politics, an Anglican in Ondo is having the same value with an Anglican in Sokoto, an Anglican in Maiduguri, an Anglican in Rivers. When you meet them, they will just be slightly different because of the environment. But they all say the same thing. They think the same. And that get the politics we want.
Thank you, sir. Yeah, I'm sure you want to say something on this, but you will round up by giving us your advice to church and Christians in general?
Well, talking about whether the church should form a political party, let's wait. Let's wait. The situation changes from time to time. Where we are now, we are in a multi-political party system of government. Mm-hmm. And to that extent, what my brother has said is quite acceptable to me. There's no need for church to form any political party because you have members of your church in different parties, so aligning yourself with one particular political party will not be the best. But that is why the people in the corridor of power must be sensitive. But if you push the country to a situation where we have two political party system, like what it was, it has almost been turned into APC, PDP. When it was UPN, was it
NPN?
NPN, UPN. In those days,
NROC,
SDP. So we have always kind of been having these two domineering political parties. And if situation happens tomorrow whereby, like the way INEC deregistered so many political parties now. Do I support that idea? It was part of our recommendation because the political terrain was becoming too wieldy. If they deregister, or we come up in this nation tomorrow whereby we have only two-party system, and one party continue to dominate and is not doing the right thing, and if they bring in religious coloration, like what happened to one of the party that is in existence today. When the party was formed, the national chairman was a Muslim. The vice chairman was a Muslim. The party secretary was a Muslim. The treasurer of the party was a Muslim. The PRO was a Muslim. And there's no room for any other person from any other religion. That is an insensitivity. And that may send a signal that may make the church as a body to form a political party. So there's nothing that is not possible. It depends on the political equation that is set on the table. Right. And that's why those in the corridor of power must be sensitive. Then on a final note to say, advice to those in governance, they should know they are there primarily to serve the people and not to serve themselves. And they should know that Nigeria today has a lot of issues that need to be handled. Right. We need to pay attention to this issue so that it will not get out of hand completely.
Thank you so much, Venerable. We want to thank Venerable Joseph Unuaya for always being there. Thank you so much for coming.
Thank
for your thought,
always
your contributions. God bless you, sir. And Engineer Bio Pomabo Awara, a former governorship candidate in Rivers. Thank you so much for coming to share your thought.
Thank you so much.
Viewers, we want to thank you for allowing us grace your TV screen. And to bring this program to a close, we want everyone to know that politics is not a dirty game. Politics is rather a game of numbers. So if you don't go in there to play politics, you will be governed. You will be led by wrong people. And so all Christians, this is Christians in politics, when we will advise that all Christians, all hands must be on deck, go and register in any political party and get ready, because 2023 is coming. Get your PVC as well. Don't wait until 2023 or 2022 December before you begin to clamor for your PVC. And this is where we want to leave it until we come your way again, same time, same station next week. God bless you and God bless Nigeria.
The views and opinions expressed on this program are those of the guests and viewers and does not necessarily reflect the views and opinions of the Advent Cable Network Nigeria, ACNNTV.